What do you make of this idea to charge people more money to go into cities? Birmingham, the latest one, that's today introduced their CAS, Clean Air Zone, that's what it stands for. And if your vehicle is a little bit more polluting, if it kicks out more emissions, you know, there's a registration checker you need to have a look at your vehicle. But if it isn't as clean as they want it to be, you will have to pay money to go into the city centre. £8 for a car or a van, £50 for a lorry or a coach. This is happening. It's happening in London. It's happening in Birmingham. It's happened already in Bath. So there's a sort of keenness on the part of the government to roll this out across the country. If you commute into Birmingham, it's going to affect you. Or if you go into the city for leisure, things like shopping at the Bullring, or you go to the theatres or anything like that, or the restaurants, and your car doesn't fit the spec on the checker, then you will have to pay. And if you don't pay, you could be slapped with a fine of £120. A little bit of breaking news in the last few minutes. We can tell you that actually you're exempt now for another couple of weeks because the council are saying it's a soft launch today. One of our reporters has been tweeting about this in Birmingham, saying that they won't be after you for the next couple of weeks. But yeah, it's happening. It's coming. And it could, if it works, and it seems to improve the air quality, which of course is the point of this, then it could be coming to a town or a city near you at some point in the future. Remember, we've got these quite stiff emissions targets. The whole country's got to be zero net carbon, isn't it, by, I think, is it 2050? So we need to crack on with this if we're going to try and do it. So is it a good idea? And will it affect you? Let me know what you think. Louis Stephen is a Green councillor in Worcester. Morning, Louis.
Good morning.
What do you reckon? Is it a good idea, the Clean Air Zone in Birmingham?
I do. I think, from a point of principle, we do need to do this. It's absolutely vital that we basically clean up the air. There's people literally who are dying every year through poor air quality. Many councils have actually been taken to court and lost. And it's something that we have to do, obviously, for clean air for people to breathe, but also, as you've said, about reducing our emissions and achieving our climate targets.
What about people who can't afford to replace their car, though, Louis? This is, already lots of people commenting about this on our Facebook page, saying this is essentially a tax on the poor.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. This is a very blunt instrument, and I think if it's the only thing you do is to introduce such a scheme, I think that's a completely wrong way to look at it, and we shouldn't be implementing a system that isn't part of a much, much more ambitious and more strategic idea. And really what we do need to do is make sure that we plan all the other things that will enable people to have time to be able to change their vehicles, but also to make sure there are viable alternatives. So today we don't have very good public transport, we don't have particularly good or very good investment in active travel, things like walking and cycling. And until our county council in Worcestershire starts getting their act together and starts to plan properly for those things, we shouldn't be implementing a scheme like this. But as part of a scheme where we are investing in public transport and active travel, at some point down the road, maybe in a few years' time, when we've got some of those measures in place, then we should be introducing some of these charges. But I think you're absolutely right. We should not be doing this without giving people a real alternative. At the moment, in Worcestershire, we don't.
But also, would it? I'm just thinking, even wider than Worcestershire, Herefordshire as well, some of the more rural bits. It kind of works in a city like London or Birmingham, doesn't it? Because you have a big city centre. Lots of people live in the city centre. You have the suburbs, which are all, 2-3 miles outside. So those journeys are doable by bus or by bike or train, and you have a much better public transport system. But somewhere like, say, somewhere really rural in Worcestershire or Herefordshire, that's not the case, is it? So it isn't really going to work around here.
Well, I think the figures in Worcester, it's something like about 50% of all of the traffic that's in the city centre is made up of people who are driving less than 2 miles. So there is a massive reduction there we could have by people using a really good public transport system. But as I say, we don't have such a system. And we obviously need to make sure we've got our urban planning right, so that we've got the right amount of jobs, services and hospitals, schools and so on, so that we minimise mass travel. And I mean, you know, a few years ago, there was a massive problem where people couldn't get their children into a local school. And most people are now forced to drive their kids from one end of the city to another through a whole lot of traffic. So it does come down to really good planning to try to reduce the amount of journeys that people need. Say things like having enough school places in the right places at the right time. Those sorts of things are important.
Louis, I sort of vaguely remember reporting on this a couple of years ago. Wasn't Lowesmoor one of the worst, in Worcester, one of the worst quality air zones? And the traffic was limited there at certain times. Did that have any effect?
It did. It did have an effect, particularly initially, but then it started to taper off. But then it's been better enforced very recently with proper cameras. And because of that, I believe that the air quality has improved. So these measures do work. If we do things that will improve the air quality, they will improve things for local people. And I think this is a really important point. If you look at the areas where we have poor air quality, places like Lowesmoor, places like Doldey, sometimes what we find is the areas with the worst air quality are also areas where we have the most, where we have the least affluence in the area. So literally, we have an inequalities issue where the people who are dying through poor air quality are people who are in the less affluent people. So there's a moral case here to be sorting out air quality in the city. And I think we owe it to future generations to make sure that we do all the steps necessary to make sure we do reduce the air pollution. If we do, I mean, but the other thing I think is really, really important is that this is not necessarily going to cost businesses a tremendous amount of money in the future, because currently today, the cost of congestion and air pollution is costing the economy billions of pounds every year. Who wants to set up a business in a city which has got poor air quality and it's got massive congestion? If we want to improve the lives of people in Worcester, we do need to make sure that we have a good air quality, low congestion, and that will really help businesses in the future as well. So it isn't all about cost, negative cost. There are massive benefits to public health and also to our businesses as well.
Good to speak to you. Thanks for having a chat this morning. Louis Stephen, Worcester Green councillor. So he's convinced. What about you? He makes some very good points about public transport. Obviously, we've talked about that a lot, haven't we? Bus provision, cycling in our two counties, not perhaps what it could be compared to places like London and Birmingham. But broadly speaking, if there are alternatives there, and